Content or audio, a division of Recorded Books presents Smashing Hitler's Panzers, The Defeat of the Hitler Youth Panzer Division in the Battle of the Bulge, by Stephen Zaloga. Narrated by Paul Brion. Introduction. Why did Hitler's 1944 Ardennes offensive fail? In his classic account of the Battle of the Bulge, John S.D. Eisenhower wrote that the action of the 2nd and 99th Divisions on the northern shoulder of the Bulge could well be considered the most decisive of the Ardennes campaign. This assessment may seem obscure for most. Indeed, the battles fought by the 2nd Infantry Division and the 99th Infantry Division during the first week of the Battle of the Bulge does not even have a commonly accepted name. It is sometimes called the Battle of the Twin Villages, although this is too narrow since the engagement encompassed fighting both before and after the struggle for the twin villages of Krinkelt-Rokeroth. A better name might be the battles for Elsenborn Ridge. Even though most of the fighting took place on the approaches to Elsenborn, and not actually on the ridge, it was this geographic feature that was key to the German Ardennes plan. Elsenborn Ridge controlled the most direct and viable route for the Wehrmacht to accomplish its operational goals in the Ardennes offensive. Stopping the Wehrmacht before the Elsenborn Ridge crushed any hope of success for Hitler's 1944 winter offensive. The battles for Elsenborn Ridge has been overlooked because most American accounts tend to assess the battle from the American perspective. To better appreciate the importance of the battles for Elsenborn Ridge, it is essential to examine the offensive from the German perspective as well as the American. The central focus of this book is the combat performance of the 12th SS Panzer Division Hitlerjugend and its American opponents in the first week of the campaign. This subject was chosen for several reasons. To begin with, the Hitlerjugend division was one of the two panzer divisions that formed the spearhead of the attack in the area that Hitler considered the Schwerpunkt, that is, the focal point of the Ardennes attack. The success or failure of these two units largely determined the eventual outcome of the campaign. It was the Hitlerjugend that was assigned the mission of overrunning the American defenses on the Elsenborn Ridge. Another reason this subject was chosen is that the performance of the Hitlerjugend division has not received as much attention as its partner in the attack, the 1st SS Panzer Division Leibstandarte Adolf Hitler. The Leibstandarte has received more coverage in English-language accounts because of its involvement in the Malmedy massacre, as well as combat actions of its most famous element, Kampfgruppe Peiper. The defeat of the 12th SS Panzer Division Hitlerjugend near Elsenborn Ridge is essential to understanding the failure of Hitler's Ardennes offensive. Technical notes. For those unfamiliar with military jargon, I've used the traditional conventions when referring to military units. The U.S. Army has traditionally used Arabic numerals for divisions and smaller independent formations, 2nd Division, 741st Tank Battalion, Roman numerals for Corps, 5 Corps, and spelled out numbers for field armies, 1st U.S. Army. Infantry battalions are sometimes abbreviated in the fashion 2nd 38th Infantry, referring to the 2nd Battalion, 38th Infantry Regiment. Within a U.S. Army infantry regiment, the three battalions had their companies lettered sequentially. So 1st Battalion consisted of A, B, and C companies. D Company was the battalion's heavy weapons, machine gun, and mortar company. The 2nd Battalion included E, F, G, and H companies. The 3rd Battalion included I, K, L, and M companies. J Company was not used to avoid confusion with I Company. The company designations were used in two fashions, A Company or Company A. The rifle platoons within an infantry company were numbered 1st, 2nd, and 3rd platoons. I have left most of the German unit designations in the standard German form. I did this to make it easier to distinguish German from American units. In a few cases where the meaning of the German designation was not obvious, I have used English for clarity. For example, Army Group B rather than Heeresgruppe B. German unit designations generally place the unit number in front of the unit type for units a division or larger, but place the numbers at the end of the unit type for units smaller than a division. So, 2nd Panzer Division, but Panzerregiment 2nd. Subunits within a small formation precede the unit designation, followed by a slash. In the case of German small unit designations, Arabic numerals indicate company, while Roman numerals indicate battalion. So, 2nd GR 990th refers to the 2nd Company of the Grenadier Regiment 990th, and Roman numeral 2, GR 990th, indicates the 2nd Battalion of the Grenadier Regiment 990th. German corps were designated with Roman numerals such as LXVII Army Corps, but the alternate version, 67th Army Corps, is used here for clarity. Field armies were designated in the fashion of 7th Army, but sometimes abbreviated AOK 7th. The former style is used here. The Waffen-SS followed normal German unit designation practices, but usually appended the unit designation with an honorific, such as 12th SS Panzer Division Hitlerjugend. Perhaps the most confusing aspect of Waffen-SS designations was their new system of ranks. The Wehrmacht in World War II tended to use centimeter measurements for the gun calibers of larger weapons, and millimeters for small arms. I have used the contemporary practice of millimeters for all types, so 75 millimeters instead of 7.5 centimeters. The maps presented here follow the usual World War II style of tactical unit symbols used by the U.S. Army. Since the convention of blue and red coloration for the opposing sides cannot be used here, German units are colored in black, American units in white. Regarding the times used in the text, the Allies began using British summer time on September 17, 1944, and the Germans went back to Central European time on October 2, 1944. So both sides were using the same clock time during the Ardennes fighting. Since much of the fighting took place in the dark, it is worth remembering that first light in Belgium in mid-December was around 0720 hours, 720 a.m., and sunrise around 0800, 8 a.m. Sunset was around 1640 hours, 4:40 p.m., with dusk lasting until 1720, 5:20 p.m. This book uses the German terminology for the chronology of the attack. The first day of the attack, Saturday, December 16, 1944, was called X Day, X Tag, and then the subsequent days in the pattern, X plus 1, X plus 2, etc. This chronology has been kept since the timetable was essential to the success or failure of the German offensive. X Day, Saturday, December 16. X plus 1, Sunday, December 17. X plus 2, Monday, December 18. X plus 3, Tuesday, December 19. X plus 4, Wednesday, December 20. X plus 5, Thursday, December 21. X plus 6, Friday, December 22. Part 1, Plans and Preparations. Hitler's Plan. The Strategic Setting. Hitler's plan for a surprise offensive in the Ardennes was prompted by Germany's desperate circumstances in the autumn of 1944. The Wehrmacht was on a death spiral to defeat. The summer campaigns had been a string of costly disasters. On the Russian front, the Red Army had launched its Operation Bagration offensive that destroyed Army Group Center, then pushed beyond the Soviet borders into Poland. This was followed by offenses in other sectors. The most consequential of these was the drive into the Balkans. The Romanian army switched sides, and Germany's main source of oil, the Romanian oil fields, fell into Soviet hands in August 1944. Germany was quickly running out of fuel to power its war machines. Following the D-Day invasion of Normandy in June 1944, the Anglo-American forces had finally broken out of Normandy, and in August 1944, trapped much of Army Group B in the Falaise Pocket. To make matters worse, a second amphibious assault, Operation Dragoon, on August 15, 1944, created a second Allied front which quickly overwhelmed Army Group G in southern and central France. The defeated Wehrmacht stumbled its way back to the German frontier in the last week of August and first weeks of September in such confusion and disarray that it was later dubbed the Void by German commanders. The scale of the disaster can be seen from German Army casualty figures. Casualties in 1944 were about double those of 1943, 2.9 million versus 1.5 million. Casualties in 1944 alone amounted to 40% of total German casualties since the start of the war. German equipment losses present much the same picture. German armored vehicle losses on the Russian front from 1941 to the end of 1943 had totaled 18,800. Losses in 1944 were 14,537 on the Russian front, plus a further 4,513 in Northwest Europe, for a total of 19,050. In other words, German armored vehicle losses in 1944 alone exceeded the entire previous 4 years of war. In the air, the Allied combined bomber offensive was destroying German cities and industries. The U.S. 8th Air Force had waged its Operation Point Blank bomber offensive against the Luftwaffe in the first half of 1944, sweeping the skies of its once dangerous foe. In the late spring and early summer, the target shifted to the German synthetic fuel industry. In combination with the loss of the Romanian oil fields, the Wehrmacht was grinding to a halt from the lack of fuel. On July 20, 1944, a faction within the army attempted to assassinate Hitler at his Wolfslayer headquarters in Prussia. Many of the army commanders had lost faith in Hitler and his war. Hitler survived, but he no longer trusted most of the senior army commanders. In the wake of the assassination attempt, Hitler took complete control of war planning and stripped German field commanders of their tactical flexibility. General Hasso von Manteuffel, commander in the Ardennes, described the consequences. The previous style of flexible and self-reliant German military leadership was paralyzed, shifting more and more to mechanical and perfunctory execution of orders issued as Führer directives, concocted in a map room far away from the battlefield. That spelled death for the traditional German art of command in mobile warfare. Even the most outstanding senior commanders raised under the traditional training regime were compelled to follow these orders to the letter and were not permitted to independently make decisions, even in small tactical matters involving single divisions. The Wehrmacht was given a brief reprieve in the early autumn of 1944. The Allies had been too successful. The advance in both the east and west had been so rapid and so deep that the Allies had overrun their supply lines and had to pause before resuming major offenses. The Wehrmacht received a last major infusion of blood. The declining supplies of fuel forced the Luftwaffe to ground many of its squadrons, except the fighter units engaged in defending the Reich. Likewise, the Kriegsmarine was forced to abandon most naval activity except for its U-boats. This freed up a large number of Air Force and Navy personnel who were transferred to the Army to help rebuild the shattered infantry and panzer divisions. In spite of Allied bomber attacks, German industry increased the production of some key weapons, including tanks and fighter planes. Yet, this was something of a magician's trick. Tank production did increase, but at the cost of spare tank parts and trucks. Now, when panzers broke down, they were lost because there were no spare parts to repair them. More fighter planes were delivered to the Luftwaffe, but in many cases, the quality was so poor that crashes outside the combat zone rose to alarming levels. In the face of these escalating disasters, Hitler reflexively chose to stage a surprise offensive in the desperate hope that a decisive victory could reverse Nazi Germany's impending slide to defeat. An offensive against the Red Army seemed pointless. It had suffered numerous crushing defeats, costing millions of soldiers, yet persevered time and time again in spite of the horrific casualties. Even if a German offensive in the east overwhelmed dozens of Red Army divisions, there seemed to be an unending supply of divisions to replace them. Hitler considered the Anglo-American forces in the west to be a more vulnerable victim for his scheme. Coalitions are inevitably more vulnerable to battlefield defeats, since defeat can breed political mistrust and dissension. Hitler convinced himself that a stunning defeat of Anglo-American forces could break the bonds between London and Washington, as had the miraculous victory in 1940 that had shattered the British and French alliance. And where better to stage the attack than in the Ardennes, the turning point of the 1940 campaign? A second Dunkirk was the alluring prize. The plan takes shape. Hitler first outlined his concept of a surprise offensive in the Ardennes on September 16, 1944, at a conference of senior commanders. He intended to punch through Allied lines through the Ardennes and then cross the Meuse River to Antwerp, thereby cutting off the British 21st Army Group from the American 12th Army Group, creating a new Dunkirk. Hitler was convinced by Clausewitz's view that the offensive was the only decisive form of war. A continued reliance on a defensive strategy would ultimately end in Germany's defeat. From a tactical perspective, Hitler's scheme was strongly shaped by two previous counteroffensives in the West, Operation Lüttich in August 1944 and the Vosges Panzer Offensive in September 1944. Operation Lüttich was a panzer attack intended to cut off the spearheads of Patton's 3rd U.S. Army by a drive to the sea at Avranches. The attack petered out almost immediately after reaching only as far as Mortain, and local German commanders blamed Allied air power for the defeat. Hitler took these observations seriously and planned to conduct the Ardennes operation in the late autumn of 1944, when the overcast skies would minimize the threat of Allied air power. The Vosges Panzer Offensive was another attempt to cut off the spearheads of the 3rd U.S. Army, but this time when Patton's forces were on the verge of linking up with the 7th U.S. Army's blitzkrieg from southern France. Instead of a massed panzer attack as envisioned by Hitler, the panzer units were committed haphazardly over the course of more than a week, diluting their combat power and dooming the offensive. From this experience, Hitler concluded that the key divisions earmarked for the Ardennes offensive must be kept in an untouchable reserve that could not be pilfered by local commanders to deal with short-term battlefield problems. On October 9, 1944, Hitler instructed Generaloberst Alfred Jodl, the Chief of Operations of the Armed Forces High Command, Oberkommando der Wehrmacht, or OKW, to produce an outline plan. The first draft was ready 3 days later. The OKW offered five options. From north to south, these operations were the Netherlands, Liège-Aachen, Luxembourg, Lorraine, and Alsace. None of these operations offered any real operational dividends except for Operation Liège-Aachen, essentially Hitler's Ardennes scheme. As a result, further planning focused on this sector. Jodl's elaboration of Operation Liège-Aachen suggested two main variations, usually dubbed the Big Solution and the Small Solution. The Big Solution, Hitler's scheme to push from the Ardennes to Antwerp and destroy the 20 to 30 Allied divisions north of the penetration, would require a strategic shift to add considerable forces in the west. Other theaters would have to be deprived of replacements and supplies in favor of the Ardennes attack force. This could include the transfer of divisions from secondary theaters such as Italy, Norway, or Greece, as well as starving the Russian front of reinforcements. Without a strategic shift in resources to the west, Jodl argued that only the small solution had any hope of success. For the small solution, he proposed a less elaborate two-pronged offensive that would envelop and destroy most of the 1st U.S. Army in the Aachen area. Jodl would later admit that he never had any confidence in Hitler's big solution, and that the OKW never prepared any detailed studies of the conduct of the offensive once it had reached the Meuse River. Hitler refused to accept Jodl's premise that the big solution would require such a major shift in resources to succeed. He argued that the surprise element of the plan would magnify the power of the attack and that the forces could be provided by concentrating those already on the Western Front. Hitler ridiculed Jodl's small solution as a half-measure, which could not decisively influence the outcome of the war. A post-war U.S. Army assessment highlighted the inherent contradictions of the big solution. The result was a triple compromise. While Hitler had continually stressed the vast import of the Ardennes offensive for the continuation of the war, he failed to draw the only possible conclusion and revise the overall strategy accordingly. Consequently, the essential number of units for the big solution could not be accumulated. But despite this glaring incongruity between forces and objectives, Hitler stubbornly clung to the big solution. Hitler's decision thus, in Jodl's words, was an act of desperation. German commanders later complained that Hitler wanted his big solution but was unwilling to pay for it with sufficient units and supplies. Jodl estimated that the big solution would take a minimum of 40 divisions. Hitler at first proposed 22 divisions, but gradually conceded that at least 29 would be needed. The total gradually increased as the demands of the mission were more fully appreciated. The initial OKW plan prepared under Jodl's direction was codenamed Wacht am Rhein, Watch on the Rhine. The codename was deliberately deceptive. Since the Allies were likely to notice the accumulation of German divisions west of the Rhine prior to the attack, a deception scheme was included in the plan. This deception scheme was intended to create the impression that the divisions were deployed there as a defensive measure to respond to the eventual Allied offensive toward the Rhine River. The two principal headquarters in the west were not informed of the watch on the Rhine until October 22, 1944. That day, the Chiefs of Staff for Generalfeldmarschall Gerd von Rundstedt's Oberbefehlshaber West, OB West, High Command West, and Generalfeldmarschall Walter Model's Army Group B appeared at Hitler's Wolfslehr command post in Prussia to be given a briefing on the goals of the offensive. Their immediate task was to take Jodl's basic concept and begin to prepare a detailed battle plan for the first phase of the operation, the breakthrough to the Meuse River. The two senior commanders on the Western Front were polar opposites in personality and style. Gerd von Rundstedt was an older and far more conventional style of German commander, a member of the traditional military caste from East Prussia's landed aristocracy. Rundstedt had joined the Prussian Army in 1892 and had served as a staff officer in World War I. His moment of battlefield glory came in May-June 1940 when he commanded Army Group A, playing the central role in the crushing defeat of the French Army. He led Army Group South in the invasion of the Soviet Union in 1941, which gutted the Red Army in the encirclement battles in Ukraine. In 1942, he was brought back from Russia to take command of OB West. Rundstedt was respected by Hitler for his competence, but was outside Hitler's circle of intimates due to his blunt honesty on military matters. He directed the fighting in Normandy in June, but his tart assessments of Germany's declining military prospects led to his relief on July 5, 1944, only a month after the start of the campaign. The disasters in Normandy in July-August 1944 forced Hitler to recall him to service in September 1944, hoping to restore some confidence in the leadership of the shattered Army of the West. Unlike Jodl, Rundstedt was not afraid to tell Hitler his misgivings about his more outlandish scheme, and as a result, his impact on the planning for the Ardennes operation was very limited. A generation younger than Rundstedt, Walter Model had been born in Saxony into a family with no military tradition at all. His father was a music teacher. He served as a young officer in World War I, and at the start of World War II, he served as a chief of staff at Corps and Field Army level in the Polish and French campaigns. He led the 3rd Panzer Division in the invasion of Russia in 1941 and steadily rose in command due to his exceptional performance. In contrast to Rundstedt's gentlemanly demeanor, Model was brash, unconventional, and ruthless. He was abusive to his staff, but he accomplished his assigned missions. Rundstedt had become disenchanted with Hitler, while Model had become beholden to the Führer after receiving a string of awards and advancements. By 1944, Model had become Hitler's miracle worker. When all seemed hopeless and defeat inevitable, Hitler called on the energetic and undefeated Model to save the day. In March 1944, he became the Wehrmacht's youngest field marshal when assigned to the key position of leading Army Group North Ukraine. When Army Group Center was shattered by the Red Army's Operation Bagration in the summer of 1944, Model was assigned by Hitler the almost hopeless task of restoring order, which he accomplished. In mid-August, after German forces in France had been surrounded in the Falaise Gap, Hitler recalled Model from the Eastern Front and assigned him command of Army Group B. Even he could not save such a hopeless situation, but he helped extract the army from its summer disaster and establish a precarious defense along the German frontier in September-October 1944. Both Rundstedt's OB West and Model's Army Group B were instructed to draw up a preliminary plan based on the OKW Watch on the Rhine outline plan. The OB West plan was codenamed Plan Martin, Fall Martin, and more closely resembled Jodl's small solution than Hitler's big solution. Plan Martin envisioned an attack out of the Ardennes to trap American forces southwest of the Meuse. Model's Army Group B plan was codenamed Herbstnebel, Autumn Mist, and likewise was a more modest offensive than Hitler's big solution. Regardless of their merits, these plans did not satisfy Hitler's ambitions. For all of Hitler's many faults, he did have a strategic vision for a decisive operation that could change the course of the war. The small solution was tactically feasible, but even if it succeeded, it would not have any strategic consequences. The problem with the big solution was its resources, not its ambitions. On November 3, 1944, Rundstedt's headquarters received Jodl's letter of instruction for Watch on the Rhine that provided far more detail than the earlier drafts. This letter rejected both Plan Martin and Herbstnebel. The key aspects of the OKW plan were clearly labeled as unalterable. Rundstedt's and Model's headquarters were expected to amplify, but not alter, the instructions to prepare their own detailed battle plans. The tentative time schedule was to have the forces in place by November 21 and to launch the Watch on the Rhine offensive on November 25, 1944. The Watch on the Rhine plan envisioned the use of three field armies. The focal point of the attack was in the north, by the 6th Panzer Army, also called by Hitler the 6th SS Panzer Army, since its corps consisted of Waffen-SS Panzer Corps. The 6th Panzer Army was nearest to Antwerp, and so was provided with the strongest concentration of panzer forces to conduct the attack. The center of the Ardennes offensive was the 5th Panzer Army that was assigned to seize the key road junction at Bastogne and fan out over the Meuse River to Antwerp and Brussels with an aim to shield the western flank of the 6th Panzer Army from Allied counterattacks. The 3rd Field Army assigned to the operation was the smallest and weakest. The 7th Army held the left southern flank and was intended solely to shield the other two field armies from American counterattacks from that direction. It had no major panzer forces and no major offensive objectives. The Watch on the Rhine plan also included an optional 4th Field Army, Army Group Student, located to the north of 6th Panzer Army. Once the Ardennes attack had succeeded in its mission, Army Group Student would be committed against the British 21st Army Group, with its mission to be determined at some future date, depending on the circumstances. It was anticipated that it would be used to exploit any of the successes won by the 6th Panzer Army. Rundstedt was insulted that Jodl had responded with such detailed and unalterable instructions without adequately considering the viewpoints of OB West and Army Group B. It had been the long-standing tradition in the German army to give local commanders greater initiative in executing battle plans. He understood that this was due to Hitler's intransigence, not Jodl. Rather than sending a detailed protest that would be ignored, he crafted a more limited response, hoping that some modest change would be permitted. He sent his response to Jodl late on November 3, outlining his objectives to the plan, and especially the inadequacy of the forces. He made several specific suggestions to improve the plan, including the need to conduct Army Group students' attack at the same time as the main offensive. Hitler rejected even these modest suggestions when he approved the operations directive for the Watch on the Rhine on November 10, 1944. If he had been careful not to express an honest opinion about Hitler's plan during the war, after the war, Rundstedt was far from scathing. Any officer attending the General Staff School who dared to submit a plan such as Watch on the Rhine, basing it on completely inadequate means and intentionally disregarding the discrepancies and capabilities between the enemy and friendly forces, would never have made the grade as a General Staff officer. In the event, the plan to launch Watch on the Rhine in late November 1944 was frustrated by a string of Allied offenses. The British 21st Army Group conducted a large operation along the Scheldt estuary to free the port of Antwerp from German interference. In mid-November, General Omar Bradley's 12th U.S. Army Group launched Operation Queen north of Aachen to try to reach the Ruhr River, while at the same time continuing the bitter fighting in the Hürtgen Forest. These actions had the greatest impact on the Ardennes force since they occurred closest to the Ardennes. The American attacks forced the commitment of some divisions earmarked for the offensive. To the south, Patton's 3rd U.S. Army launched Operation Madison to clear the Metz fortified area and to push toward the Saar region. Farther south, Lieutenant General Jacob Deaver's 6th Army Group pushed over the Vosges Mountains toward Strasbourg and through the Belfort Gap, reaching the Rhine River. These operations tied down several divisions that were originally assigned to the Ardennes offensive. As a result of these Allied initiatives, the launch date for Watch on the Rhine was continually pushed back into December 1944. Hitler considered that surprise was essential to the success of Watch on the Rhine. Should the Allies understand the intent of the buildup west of the Rhine, they could readily reinforce the Ardennes sector. As a result, discussion of the plans was kept to a bare minimum of senior commanders, who swore an oath of secrecy on pain of death. Hitler had lost trust in the generals since the July 20, 1944 bomb plot and apparently considered a leak from a disloyal officer to be the main threat rather than Allied interception of radio messages. The plans were not transmitted by radio or teletype and instead were shared among the senior commands by means of couriers. As a result, the Allies never discovered the plans until after the attack was launched. Hitler's insistence on absolute secrecy also impacted tactical preparations for Watch on the Rhine. On November 18, 1944, Jodl sent out a directive on assault tactics based on Hitler's conceptions. This covered 7 main issues: the time for the start of the offensive, artillery preparations, organization of assault forces, the breakthrough, the post-breakthrough phase, Luftwaffe cooperation, and flak and supply issues. This seemingly mundane directive would in fact have profound consequences to the conduct of the offensive, as will be detailed later. The senior commanders remained very uneasy about the prospects for the Ardennes mission, and debate continued well into November. Rundstedt considered the big solution to be completely impossible in view of the limited forces available, and that even the small solution would have modest chances at best. Model was equally skeptical of the plan, calling it damned fragile. Rundstedt and Model continued to push for the small solution plan through the end of November 1944. Nevertheless, Hitler refused to change course. The final detailed version of the plan was drafted by Model's Army Group B headquarters on November 29, 1944, and adopted as Operation Order, Operationsbefehl, Autumn Mist, on December 9 after Hitler had made some minor changes. Movement would begin on December 10 and X Day was scheduled to be Saturday, December 16, 1944. Schwerpunkt. The Schwerpunkt, or focal point, of the Ardennes offensive was the 6th Panzer Army on the northern flank of the assault. Hitler habitually referred to this command as the 6th SS Panzer Army, though it was not officially designated as such until January 1945. Its affiliation with the Waffen-SS was one of the reasons it was selected to be the focus of the attack. Since the July 1944 bomb plot, Hitler had increasingly turned to the Waffen-SS for the most difficult missions, since he was increasingly distrustful of the leadership of the regular army, the Heer. The Waffen-SS was the military arm of the Nazi Party, inculcated with its ideology. The Waffen-SS was given preference for equipment, and its commanders were selected more for political reliability than battlefield expertise. From a tactical standpoint, the 6th Panzer Army was the focal point, since its sector was seen as the most essential for the success of the mission. Hitler's first draft of the plan described the mission of the 6th Panzer Army. 6th SS Panzer Army will boldly seize the crossings over the Meuse River astride Liège to secure them in cooperation with Operation S. It will establish strong defensive positions facing north on the Vendre River, including the eastern fortifications of Liège. It will reach the Albert Canal between Maastricht and Antwerp and secure the area north of Antwerp. The 6th Panzer Army would launch its attack from the forested Eifel region into the Ardennes south of Monschau. The 6th Panzer Army sector was significantly closer to the main objective of Antwerp than was the start point for the neighboring 5th Panzer Army, located farther south near Bastogne. Its proximity to Antwerp was essential since the Ardennes plan relied on speed. Even Hitler appreciated that time was on the Allied side, and he expected that German forces could reach Antwerp within a week from the start of the offensive. If the German spearheads were not quick enough in reaching their objectives, the Allies could mobilize greater forces to block their path. The shorter the route, the more likely its success. The 6th Panzer Army Commander. The 6th Panzer Army was led by SS Obersgruppenführer Josef Sepp Dietrich. Unlike the other senior German commanders in the Ardennes, he had no formal officer training. Senior German commanders regarded him as an uncouth lout and a dim sycophant of the Führer. His military talents were damned with faint praise as those of a splendid sergeant. Rundstedt was very uncomfortable relying on the 6th Panzer Army as the Schwerpunkt of the offensive due to Dietrich's limitations as a commander. He judged Dietrich as decent but stupid. Rundstedt knew very well that Hitler would not countenance Dietrich's replacement, but he did insist that Dietrich's current chief of staff, Generalleutnant Alfred Gauss, be replaced by the ablest and most outstanding Panzer Army chief of staff to be found on the Eastern Front. There was some hope that if a skilled commander could be appointed as Dietrich's chief of staff, this might make up for Dietrich's limitations. In the event, Generalmajor der Waffen SS Fritz Kramer was appointed to this position at the beginning of December 1944. During its expansion in 1943, the Waffen-SS suffered from a shortage of formally trained staff officers. Kramer was a former regular army Heer staff officer who was seconded to the Waffen-SS in 1943, initially serving as Dietrich's chief of staff when leading the 1st SS Panzer Corps in Russia. Kramer was probably not Rundstedt's ideal choice, but he had served ably as Dietrich's chief of staff in the 1st SS Panzer Corps in Normandy. Given the short preparation time before the offensive, it was more prudent to rely on a proven partnership than to risk the potential clash between two unacquainted and headstrong commanders. Dietrich was a jovial, hard-drinking, and down-to-earth commander who was very popular with his troops. Brutal to opponents, he was maudlin and sentimental with his own soldiers. Dietrich had won the Iron Cross in World War I in a stormtroop unit and served in one of the few German tank units during 1918. He fought against the Poles with the Silesian militias in 1921 and returned to Bavaria to serve as a policeman since there were few opportunities in the army. Dietrich joined the Nazi Party in 1928 and was promoted to command of the Munich SS, Schutzstaffeln, a group of toughs formed as a personal guard for Hitler in the rough-and-tumble street politics of the fractious Weimar Republic. Hitler's trust in Dietrich as a reliable enforcer led to his appointment as the head of the enlarged SS-Leibstandarte Adolf Hitler, Adolf Hitler bodyguard, after he became chancellor in 1933. Dietrich demonstrated his loyalty to Hitler by rounding up his brown shirt comrades for summary execution in the Night of the Long Knives in 1934, when Hitler ordered the SA Sturmabteilung crushed to curry favor with the army. The Leibstandarte was committed to combat for the first time during the 1939 Polish campaign, gradually shaking off the reputation as asphalt soldiers. Dietrich was a charismatic fighter, but unprepared in intellect or training to command a large formation. So the practice began of placing him in a prominent position while at the same time assigning a talented officer as his chief of staff to carry out the actual headquarters and staff functions. Later evaluations of Dietrich by U.S. Army interrogators tended to reflect the opinions of German commanders from the Heer. He was described by American interviewers as a crude, loquacious, hard-bitten, tough man whose statements are often inaccurate, yet also a man having a great deal of common sense. His fellow officers, the more class-conscious of whom are often shocked at Dietrich's language and behavior, attribute his meteoric rise in the army to his Nazi Party connections. First Lieutenant Robert E. Merriam remarked, "Dietrich is regarded in low esteem by his fellow officers. He did not seem to have a grasp of the operations of his army in the Ardennes, and was unable to present a comprehensive picture of the happenings, even in the most general terms." Dietrich was Hitler's alter ego, a common soldier of the Great War, a man of the people, a man of action, and the polar opposite of the type of intellectual, aristocratic Prussian staff officer that Hitler so despised. He was awarded the Iron Cross 1st and 2nd Class for the undistinguished performance of the Leibstandarte in Poland, and the Knight's Cross for their modest role in the French campaign. These were the first of many preposterous awards and rank increases that Hitler used as much to rankle the blue bloods of the German military establishment as to reward Dietrich. In 1943, Dietrich was ordered to form the 1st SS Panzer Corps. The corps was first committed to action in Normandy, where it earned a formidable reputation for its obstinate and skilled defense of Caen against British tank assaults. On August 1, 1944, Dietrich was elevated to SS Obersgruppenführer, and a few days later Hitler added diamonds to his Iron Cross, one of only 27 soldiers so decorated during the war. On September 14, 1944, Hitler instructed him to begin the formation of the 6th Panzer Armee. Dietrich had grown increasingly despondent over the conduct of the war, but he was too inarticulate to convey his views, and too beholden to his Nazi sponsors to press his complaints with any conviction. He drank heavily and vaguely blamed the setbacks at the front on sabotage. He was unwilling to recognize that the source of the problem was the regime he so ardently served. Organization of the 6th Panzer Armee. Dietrich's 6th Panzer Armee consisted of three corps: 1st SS Panzer Corps, 2nd SS Panzer Corps, and 57th Armee Corps. The front assigned to the 6th Panzer Armee was quite narrow, only about 20 kilometers, 13 miles wide. The plan was to begin the attack with the 1st SS Panzer Corps attacking toward Elsenborn and the Losheim Gap, while the 57th Armee Corps on its right flank would push into the Monschau Forest. The 2nd SS Panzer Corps would wait until the 1st SS Panzer Corps had secured the breakthrough, and then exploit the penetration in a race to Antwerp. The 57th Armee Corps, under the command of General der Infanterie Otto Hitzfeld, was by far the weakest of the three corps and had the least ambitious mission. In many respects, it mirrored the role of the 7th Army to the south, to shield the shoulder of the offensive using a modest infantry force. The 1st U.S. Army was very active in the Monschau area as part of its bloody campaign to reach the Ruhr River dams, and Hitzfeld's corps was assigned to keep the American infantry in the sector tied down and away from the main attack sector farther south. Autumn Mist Tactics. The tactics of the Autumn Mist Plan were textbook 1944 pattern, with the infantry divisions executing the tactical breakthrough of the American defenses, followed by the operational breakthrough by the panzer divisions. The 1st Panzer Corps had 3 infantry divisions assigned to the initial breakthrough mission. Once this operation was completed, these units were expected to make a wide swing to the northwest to create a blocking line from Liège to Monschau to prevent Allied divisions from interfering on the right flank of the panzer breakthrough. This blocking line would include the 3 infantry divisions assigned to the 1st Panzer Corps, as well as 2 infantry divisions in Hitzfeld's 57th Army Corps. The 2 panzer corps were expected to bear the burden of the attack. The 1st SS Panzer Corps was assigned as the spearhead to conduct the initial breakthrough by way of Elsenborn and the Losheim Gap and race to the Meuse River crossings. At this point, the 2nd SS Panzer Corps would be injected into the battle. In the event that the 1st SS Panzer Corps had suffered heavy losses in the breakthrough phase, the 2nd SS Panzer Corps would follow behind to conduct the exploitation phase beyond the Meuse River. In the event that the 1st SS Panzer Corps was still relatively intact, both corps would proceed in parallel, with the 2nd SS Panzer Corps most likely forming the right flank of the attack from the Elsenborn area toward Antwerp. At this stage, Army Group Student would also be available to further amplify the attack in the northern sector out of the Aachen area. Aside from the narrowness of the attack front, the other reason the 2 panzer corps were scheduled to attack in sequence was that the road network in this area was not suitable for a concentrated panzer attack. The front lines in this sector ran along the international highway, Reichstrasse 258, with a significant forest immediately to the west. This area, along the German-Belgian border, has relatively good north-south roads emanating from Aachen, but the east-west road network was poor until reaching the road network emanating from Liège. The forest in this area was used for logging, and so was relatively free of underbrush and traversable by infantry. However, the road network through the forest consisted mainly of paths and firebreaks that were only marginally suitable for vehicular traffic. For the attack plan to succeed, the American defenses in the forest had to be rapidly overwhelmed to permit the mechanized columns to reach open farmland on the other side of the woods. A total of 5 routes, called Rohbahn, were assigned to the 2 panzer divisions of the 1st SS Panzer Corps. These routes were reserved for the panzer units, and the accompanying infantry divisions were explicitly instructed to avoid clogging these routes until after the panzer spearheads had passed. The 5 routes were labeled as Rohbahn A through E, with the 3 northern routes, A through C, assigned to 12th SS Panzer Division Hitlerjugend, and the remaining 2 of its southern neighbor, 1st SS Panzer Division Leibstandarte Adolf Hitler. Of the 5 routes, the northernmost, Rohbahn A, was judged to be inadequate for extensive tank use and instead was slated to be used only for a reinforced armed reconnaissance detachment. In the event, Rohbahn A would take on far greater importance than envisioned in the original plan. Within the 1st SS Panzer Corps, the focal point was the center of the sector, Rohbahn D for the 1st SS Panzer Division, and Rohbahn C for the 12th SS Panzer Division. Both of these routes passed through the Losheim Gap. This started with a narrow band of forest northwest of Losheim, exiting into open farmland with a good road network heading to the northwest. No specific time schedule was set for the offensive, though there were some rough expectations about the likely progress of the operation. It was anticipated that the infantry divisions would fight their way through the forests on the morning of the first day, advancing to a depth of 5 to 6 kilometers by midday. The original OKW plan expected that the Meuse would be reached in 2 days. The 6th Panzer Army had less optimistic expectations. Army Chief of Staff Fritz Kramer expected it would take 1 day to break through the American defenses and 1 day for the Spearhead Panzer Divisions to pass over the Hohesven Highlands with arrival near the Meuse on the evening of the 3rd day and the crossing of the Meuse on the 4th day. The Artillery Dilemma. There was considerable controversy about the artillery preparation at the start of the autumn mist attack. Dietrich's 6th Panzer Army followed the November 18, 1944 tactical guidelines from Hitler to the letter. The neighboring 5th Panzer Army, led by the dynamic panzer commander Hosso von Manteuffel, had very serious reservations about Berlin's artillery instructions. Artillery could undoubtedly soften up an enemy infantry defense if applied with enough accuracy and enough volume. Hitler's instructions undermined the value of the artillery preparation by insisting that none of the new divisional artillery battalions or supporting corps artillery could register their targets before the attack. This was to maintain the absolute secrecy essential to the attack. To ensure accuracy, field artillery batteries normally would conduct a few registration fires to make certain that the main barrage would hit where intended. Without the registration, field artillery loses its accuracy. A further impediment was Hitler's insistence that deep reconnaissance into the American lines be curtailed prior to the offensive to create the impression that the Ardennes was a quiet front. This further weakened the potential of the artillery, since the artillery fire control units lacked detailed information on the location of American defenses. Artillery observation batteries were deployed in late November and early December to collect data on U.S. field artillery battery locations by means of flash observation and sound ranging. This precipitated a crisis on December 2, 1944, when two forward observers from 1st SS Panzer Corps were captured by U.S. patrols, leading to some fear that the autumn mist plans might be compromised. This led to further restrictions on artillery reconnaissance. The German artillery batteries did not have enough ammunition to bombard the entire front, and furthermore, Hitler insisted that the preliminary softening of the American infantry positions be limited to an hour. It was later shortened to a half hour. In view of the lack of precise targeting information, this implied that the artillery preparation would not be accurate enough or powerful enough to significantly damage the American infantry defenses. Besides these problems, the American forward defenses were located in the forest belt along the Belgian frontier. Forests pose a significant problem for artillery firing against defended positions. This should have been clear to both sides as a result of the brutal fighting in the nearby Hürtgen Forest that had been taking place since September 1944. The artillery projectiles would usually detonate in the upper branches of the trees. This sprayed the area below with a lethal combination of blast, fragments, and wood splinters, killing or injuring any exposed infantry. But it was nearly worthless when the enemy infantry was protected. The American defenses were in many cases based in earthen bunkers with log roofs, which were nearly invulnerable to tree bursts. Unless the American infantry was caught out in the open, the artillery bombardment would be nearly useless. Manteuffel's solution was to rely on 1918 tactics, which favored infiltration over firepower. He argued that the artillery preparation as conceived would be inadequate, and moreover, would only serve to alert the Americans to the impending infantry assault, giving them time to man their forward defenses. Instead, Manteuffel wanted to infiltrate at least a battalion from each infantry regiment through the weakly defended American lines, cutting off and encircling the forward American defenses. His suggestions to the OKW in this regard were rebuffed. Manteuffel conveniently ignored Berlin's orders, and the 5th Panzer Army used infiltration tactics with considerable success, with the storm battalions infiltrating like raindrops through the American front. Manteuffel's view on the issue was shared by the staff of Price's 1st SS Panzer Corps. Corps headquarters had repeatedly requested that there be no preparatory barrage, but that the artillery open fire at the beginning of the attack. This was all the more advisable because the enemy positions in the attack sector were deployed 7 to 9 kilometers deep. Their locations could not be determined, and the amount of ammunition available was not enough for a rolling barrage. Moreover, Corps headquarters believed that a one-hour artillery preparation along this completely quiet front would surrender the advantage of secrecy 1 hour too soon. The attack troops would thereby be deprived of the great advantage of surprise without gaining any essential fire support. Corps headquarters' requests in this regards were refused. Dietrich and his staff tended to be far more compliant with the OKW instructions and lacked the tactical foresight of more skilled commanders like Manteuffel. This would have ruinous consequences on the first day of the attack. Infantry Spearhead. The Hollywood depiction of the Battle of the Bulge usually portrays the panzer divisions as the spearhead of the attack. This was not the case in 1944. The proliferation of infantry anti-tank weapons, such as the American 2.36-inch bazooka and the German Panzerfaust, made it very dangerous for tanks to attempt to push through dense infantry defenses because these defenses could slow the attack and lead to unacceptably high tank losses. Infantry, with armored vehicle support, was considered a more effective means to break through enemy infantry defenses. Once the infantry defenses were...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.